So all of us are here tonight because we have a disdain for poverty. We hate when we hear stories about children that can't finish school because of diseases. We hate when we hear about mothers that died. That Kenya technology. We hate when we hear stories about mothers that die prematurely because of diseases, or orphans that die because of starvation. We hear about these lands that have vast areas, but no opportunities and no jobs. And that's where we ask the question and we say, but what if? What if the food, the health, the opportunities, and a thriving life was actually possible for those living in extreme poverty? What if I told you the child that dies every 2 minutes from malaria doesn't have to? What if all of that could be prevented in something as small as a seed from a garden? Let me ask you, how do you feel when you're eating nutritious, healthy food? Do you feel that you perform every single day better? Do you feel that you are better in your life? Do you feel the impact that your food has on you? When you walked in at the reception table, you probably saw a brown bowl of some white stuff in it. Can you imagine if you had to overcome all the challenges of life and all you got for nutrition was something like that? The issue is that for the decades, we have been exporting our modern farming techniques, where now those in poverty, they have a single source, as Ryan mentioned, living off corn. About 90% of diets consists of that. And even now, most development organizations, we talk about the solution to end poverty. It's farming, it's about our agriculture. And that is just a continuance of the same problems. Those in poverty, they have what we like to call hidden hunger. They're actually starving for nutrition. So as you've seen at Thrive for Good, we train and we equip people with hidden hunger. We train them how to grow an abundance of healthy, organic, disease-fighting food and medicinal plants. There's with knowledge, simple tools, and small seeds, people who cannot afford to buy healthy food are now empowered to grow their own food. And best of all, they can actually do it sustainably. We call these projects life gardens because they are growing health on their own, and that's the first step out of poverty. You would have seen our example when you walk in. Because when communities, when they can grow their own nutritious, healthy food, disease rates drop. Children can stay in school longer. Mothers and fathers, they can actually stay healthy and provide for their kids. They can grow surplus in their gardens and provide income. It costs less than $750 to support one community of 50 people with a life garden. And they can grow life, they can grow health for a lifetime. They can then take health into their own hands and step out of poverty. Last month, I was traveling in Kenya and visited a handful of projects that have life gardens. We visited orphanages, schools, and actually, like Ryan, even went into prisons. While I was at Showgrounds Community School, we heard a class president, who's 12 years old, fourth grader, talk about the Thrive Gardens at the school. They now have 140 gardens and are growing such a surplus that the classmates are paying for all of their school supplies and uniforms. Bronley, I was so impressed with Bronley's knowledge about nutrition, about crop rotation, about soil preparation. It was amazing. But even more amazing than that was to hear the principal of the school talk. He hasn't had malaria in 4 years where he's been malaria free. Ever since Thrive started having life gardens in the community, and he began taking the Artemisia tea, or Artemisia root as a tea, which is an anti-malarial, he's been malaria free. Life gardens grow this disease-fighting food. Samson used to fall sick 3 to 4 times a year, and he would often miss 5, 6, 7 weeks a year of work. Traveling to the projects, I heard testimony after testimony after testimony of the same thing, where people are malaria-free and they're healthy. To date, Thrive is in 7 countries, 700 communities, impacting over 30,000 people. As you can imagine, with this simple simple methodology and the power that is in a life garden, it is extremely scalable. A single family can use a life garden as a kitchen garden in their local place. They can also, we can use it for large organizations, such as orphanages, hospitals, clinics, prisons, and even refugee camps. Through the help of our partners at Traction at Demand, which a number are here, we have built a powerful back end. We've built a powerful back end using Salesforce that allows us to measure, monitor, and evaluate every single garden. You might have noticed when you were trying the virtual reality goggles, you would have seen a poster. That's actually a copy of our dashboard from last month. We can measure the quality of every garden, the food produced, and even the amount of food that is produced in that garden. So moving forward, our strategy is to scale through partnerships with other charities. We come alongside other charities, identify a champion, train and equip the champion inside the organization. By partnering with charities, we can amplify the work that they are already doing. Their development efforts are then increased because the people they're working with are now healthy. For example, in 2017, we partnered with an orphanage in Zambia. We sent them a trainer to start teaching and training life gardens. The challenge that this orphanage had with 2,000 children, even at 75 cents a day for food, they were spending $500,000 a year in food. After 9 months of training and having life gardens, they dropped their expense by 93%. That's a savings of $480,000 that they can use on education, latrines, even expansion of their care program. For me personally, this idea of change and impact and the different focus on ending poverty is powerful. I was first introduced to Thrive about a year ago when I was invited by one of the most generous, authentic, smartest men that I know, and he said, "This methodology of life gardens, it has the potential to change everything, and it can seriously disrupt the fight against poverty." And in his direct German tone, he said, "It's cheap as borscht." And he said, "The impact is truly sustainable and it's scalable. We can provide training to an entire community with just simple tools and training, and it's pennies on the dollar." He said, "Let's change the common conventional approach and train the poor how to come out of poverty on their own." Although I was skeptical, I went to Kenya and I visited. And after experiencing it, I actually caught the vision and completely got it. Tonight, join a growing group of risk takers and entrepreneurs that want change. If we don't grow this model, the old methods will continue and they will perpetuate. It's our time to change these conventional approaches of farming and to focus on the absolute necessity of health, which comes through nutrition. It's stories like the orphanage in Zambia, stories like Samson, and future leaders like Bromley that all require the opportunity of having a first seed, and it's up to us to empower them with that first seed. With that, I want to invite Ken Bell, who's going to come over here. Ken's going to introduce 8 life-changing projects to us that we have the opportunity to empower and to fund and make the difference in the lives of 10,000 people.